This is Tom Ivers. Welcome to Interval Training at Standardbred. In this tape, we're going to try to show you all the aspects of interval training so that you can do it yourself and reap the advantages of a scientific method of conditioning. Let's start out with why. You know, there are natural athletes and there are unnatural athletes. And natural athletes tend to be good at athletics, whether it's humans or equines, they tend to be automatically good at athletics. And a lot of this has to do with breeding or genetics. A lot of it has to do with luck. But there are some athletes that just naturally adapt quickly to any kind of exertional stress and come on to be well-coordinated, high-energy athletes. But let's think of it in terms of what can be done to an athlete that is not a natural athlete. Think of a Jaguar automobile, or a Porsche, which is designed to cruise at 140 miles an hour along the German Autobahn, and the American Buick V6, which is designed to hemorrhage internally at 90 miles an hour. And let's bring both of these over to America and put them on America's highways and take that Porsche at 55 miles an hour for 6 months, and the net result of that kind of training is that the Porsche begins slowly to throw out blue smoke, and on down the line it's throwing out blue smoke and black smoke, and its cruising speed as it detunes and as it gets used to this 55 mile an hour speed limit drops to, let's say, 110. And if at the same time you took the Buick V6 to the garage and put bored the cylinders, put a turbocharger on it, put racing suspension on it, and then took both cars back out to the highway and raced them, you'd find that the Buick V6 would be competitive with the deconditioned Porsche. And that's what we're talking about here with a good conditioning program, is the ability to enhance a top-notch athlete or a mediocre athlete, make that athlete go faster. The process starts with background mileage, and background mileage is structural conditioning. What we're looking for is to make the collagen and the tendons and ligaments bind together and get thicker and tougher. And that same collagen is contained in the fiber bags around the muscles and internal organs, the fascia. And that gets thicker and tougher just with exercise, slow exercise. Slow exercise will gradually thicken the cartilage, make it healthy, and make it exude quality hyaluronic acid. Slow mileage will build gradually bone density, bone thickness, bone strength and flexibility. A volume of slow exercise, for example 6 miles a day, will give the horse a workload, a daily workload, that later on can be manipulated, changed, and shaped to to work that's more important or more relevant to racing speeds. Without a background foundation, though, you can't do too much. You can't do too much in the way of specific race exercises because you haven't got the volume going. In addition, you're teaching your horse to eat and use his food for energy. You're teaching his body to convert more and more feed to energy. You're also changing stupid legs to smart legs. Neuromuscular coordination develops with every step the horse takes. And if you leave the horse out in the paddock, typically he'll deliver you 22 miles a day of walking, trotting, cantering, galloping, pacing. But once you bring him into a stall, the racetrack, he stops delivering that kind of mileage, and it's up to you to deliver whatever you can. In some countries, 18 miles a day is being delivered. In Australia, that's not untypical. New Zealand, it's not untypical. Here, all we're suggesting is 6 miles a day. If we can get that done, then we can do 3 miles of high-intensity exercise twice a week when we're working in the interval training stage. As we progress in the conditioning process, the second stage, which flows right from the background mileage stage, begins to stress the cardiovascular system, the plumbing of the horse. And in this stage, we begin interval training. Now, interval training is easily defined. It's a very simple process. It's simply a matter of multiple heats of exercise separated by partial recovery rest periods. And it differs from the conventional standardbred training process in that when we shoot 3 miles, instead of taking the horse back to the barn, we stay on the track and we walk and trot or walk and pace for 10-minute rest periods between the miles. Later on, it'll be 7-minute rest periods between three-quarter heats and 5-minute rest periods between half miles. And these partial recovery rest periods allow you to develop speed while tying the total exercise together for a cumulative effect in building staying power. And in the second stage, staying power means oxygen delivery and oxygen uptake in the muscle cells. But you have to build the plumbing system first, and the thing about the equine cardiovascular system that makes it tough to stress and develop extra cardiovascular ability is the fact that the horse carries around in his spleen 50% of his red blood cells when he's at rest. And when his energy systems are challenged by high-level exercise, that spleen contracts and the PCV count in the bloodstream goes from a low of 33 to 35 to 64 to 66%. And that means the horse carries a natural backpack of endurance around with him. And to challenge then his oxygen delivery system is difficult. You have to get up to high speeds and maintain, sustain those high speeds for a long time before you begin to starve his muscle cells of oxygen. If you're going to improve his cardiovascular system, then you have to challenge it. In this case, we're doing, you see a horse at Cornell University doing 3 times 1 mile heats. In this case, the fastest is going to be in a roughly 230 rate. We take our 3 times 1 mile workouts all the way down to 210 the fastest. We'll start at maybe 310 fastest. If we did 310 fastest, the second heat would be in 320. And the first heat would be in 330, so we'd have 330, 320, 310 with 10-minute rest periods between. Later on, we'll be going 230, 220, 210. This is the kind of workout that built Cam Fella. Cam Fella stopped with multiple miles and went on to race from there. Stopped at roughly around 210 fastest. We did these workouts twice a week, just like conventional standardbred training. Now, as you're sitting there watching this videotape, 90% of your blood vessels are closed. They're not operating. And in order for you to really open them up, you'd have to do some pretty strenuous exercise. And that's the same for the horse. And so while we begin at 310, we don't really start doing a whole lot of good until we're down below a 230 rate of speed. And what happens then is that we begin activating fast twitch muscle cells. And fast twitch muscle cells normally don't use oxygen. They burn partially. They burn enzymatically and throw off lactic acid. And lactic acid in large quantities tends to paralyze muscles. The blood pH and the muscle pH goes down and the muscle cells stop functioning. And you get fatigued and fetlocks begin to droop to the ground and missteps, bowed tendons, chipped knees, chipped ankles, all the things that go wrong at high levels of fatigue. Now, as we challenge these fast twitch muscle cells, one of the things that happens is the fast twitch muscle cells learn to use oxygen. They develop mitochondria within them, and these are little factories that burn fuel through the use of oxygen. And these mitochondria contain oxidative enzymes, which are quite functional in burning lactate. So as some fast twitch muscle cells are throwing off, in fact all the muscle cells at high rates of speed throw off lactate in great amounts. As this lactate is thrown off, it's shunted towards muscle cells which can burn lactate through the use of oxygen. And as we go through the cardiovascular conditioning stage, we're building more and more mitochondria in the fast twitch muscle cells, which means that the horse can tolerate higher and higher levels of lactic acid. Not only tolerate it, but use it as fuel, use it as the principal fuel of exercise. In this exercise you're watching, the horse is wearing an onboard heart rate monitor. In fact, the heart rate monitor that I use was invented and developed at Cornell University by Dr. George Malin. She's also wearing a radio, a helmet, with a radio that she broadcasts back, every eighth of a mile, she broadcasts back the heart rate that the horse is experiencing. And Dr. George Malin's on the sideline here. He's recording those numbers. And actually, the heart watch that she wears can be brought back and put into a computer. And the entire workout with its heart rate responses can be graphed and saved. And the key to heart rate monitoring, your horse's heart will go from 33 to 39 resting rate to as high as 240 beats a minute. And of course, that spleen ejects somewhere in the middle of the process so that you've got 240 beats a minute of double thick blood coursing through the horse's veins. This puts a lot of stress on the vascular bed, on the capillaries of the heart-lung interface. We know that 65 to 70% of thoroughbreds bleed in races, and this is principally because they don't get any cardiovascular conditioning, and consequently their vasculature is minimally developed, and it's like hooking up a garden hose to the Alaska pipeline. Something has to blow, and it's usually the small, tiny capillaries in the heart-lung interface that just explode with this new high, extra high load of pressure and due to the speed and due to the contraction of the spleen. So here we're watching a horse. This horse will develop about a 222 heart rate as it goes around this last heat. The last heat will be in about 230. This horse is midway through the cardiovascular conditioning stage. Of course, during this stage, the structural and neuromuscular conditioning continues, and it's continued in a very gradual way. There's no surprises, no big change in exercise protocol. Speed is brought on slice by slice. The horse is carefully watched. If there are any signs at all of problems, the horse is backed up, and the shoeing and the gating and the medical aspects are all closely watched so that any kind of injury is avoided. And really, before the horse crosses the 220 line, the animal is perfectly gated, should be perfectly gated. See the electrodes for the heart rate meter being put on. These are stick-ons, and normally you don't have to shave the hair of the horse to get the electrodes to stick. You push them down around the outside tightly. The horse loves it. There's George Malin in the background. One goes on the neck and one goes on the belly of the horse. Both electrodes were trying to avoid large muscle masses because the heart rate monitors tend to want to pick up artifact, including muscle firings. Every time a muscle fires, it throws off an electrical charge that is similar to the charge thrown off by the heart, which the heart rate monitor picks up. built into the saddle pad or the girth pad is a small transmitter that then broadcasts the heart rate to a wristwatch worn by the rider in the case of thoroughbreds, and there's the girl putting on the watch right now. Thus, no wires are attached to the horse, and the driver can sit back and not feel encumbered by wires hooked to the horse. And this is a lot better than some other meters, which hook you to the horse, and as soon as something happens, as soon as the horse goes crazy and somebody falls off, the wires are pulled out and the heart rate meter is damaged, sometimes beyond repair. She's attaching the electrodes to the small transmitter put in the blanket. We'll see the heart rate meter on a standardbred in a second, but you can see how small that transmitter is. It's very lightweight, very easy to use. The question, can you do interval training without a heart rate monitor? Yes, you certainly can, and no gadgets are necessary, but the heart rate meter certainly helps to allow you to know what was going on. Here's yours truly, looking at a horse that has two electrodes on the neck, one just in case one slides off, and you've got the second one up there. You don't have to do this, but in this case we did. And there on the belly is the other electrode. And the transmitter's hidden away. You can't see it here, but it's being used, and it turns out to be quite accurate. This is the horse that you just saw do the 3x1 mile heats. This is before. When this horse came back off the exercise, the internal body temperature of the horse was 108 degrees. Nevertheless, the animal thrived on the exercise and still continues today to work her way down through. Now she's going, doing multiple 3/4, and she'll be ready to race soon. You can see the antenna of the radio flashing in the sunlight there on the driver's, near the driver's helmet. And again, if you're training several horses at once, these radios are quite useful. Now you can see her placing the heart rate watch into the black box that sends the information to the computer. And this, if you're doing research, as is being done at Cornell University, this is quite useful to go back over and watch all the heart rate responses from all the horses going through the programs. The computer will draw a chart of the heart rate process during a workout. Every 5 seconds, the heart rate is recorded, and the heart rate watch will remember about an hour and 20 minutes worth of heart rate data. And then a graph can be printed out if you want to, or you can just store the data for later reference. This is a plotter doing its tricks. Its plotters are kind of fun to watch. The plotter has a little pen in it that it just draws the numbers and the charts very precisely, so you get a very good, accurate graph. Now here is the chart, coming up is the chart of the horse that we just did with its 3 heats. And you can see now, of course, these were rolling starts. All interval training is rolling starts. And you can see that the heart rate is up in the neighborhood of 220 on all three heats, but the third heat is the highest. And you can see that as the horse crosses the finish line, the heart rate drops off dramatically. And that's the key to good fitness in a horse, is you want that recovery rate to drop very rapidly. And you notice that the recovery on the third heat, which is the highest line there, is just below 250 at a minute. We have 1 minute, 2 minute, 3 minute, 4 minute, etc. Readings there. And that 1 minute heart rate is what we're looking for at as our recovery heart rate. You can see that it drops dramatically, then tends to want to plateau off a little bit, and then gradually drifts on down. There's the 1 minute, 2 minute, 3 minute recoveries. And we have a rule about these recovery heart rates at 1 minute. There are certain indications that we're getting into the horse either just right or a little too much. And when we know we're getting in too deeply, we just stop the workout. Now, other ways to stop the workouts are just to wait until the horse spits the bit or wants to slow down. And as soon as that happens, we quit. But in normal heart rate recoveries, if we see a heart rate above 140, we quit. That's a 1 minute recovery heart rate. If we see between 125 and 140, we look at the horse and try to decide whether or not the horse wants to go on, can go on. Between 105 and 125 heart rate at 1 minute after the finish line, we know we're right on track and we know we're going to get the job done. And we know that it's safe to go on. Below 105, we're just not getting good exercise into the horse. We need to do a little bit faster workout. So those are the basic parameters. Now, I've had horses doing 8 times a half mile where their heart rates never drop below 165, but that's experimental, and it's something that really, the first time around, you really don't want to try. Doug Arthur was interval training horses long before the Fit Racehorse came out. He's an extremely talented horseman. He trained Cam Fella and Justin Passing with a 3x1 mile interval protocol, again with 10 minute rest periods, all the way down to 210. He trains, this process is similar to a process that is used in Australia by John McMullen, who sends 20 to 25 horses to Mike Gagliardi at the Meadowlands.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm not sure, I haven't decided whether it's an advantage or a disadvantage to speak later in the program. Probably a little of each. Nonetheless, I'm happy to be here to talk about a subject that I'm very enthusiastic about. My purpose is to relate to you the current method I am using to train horses to race as two-year-olds. I'd like to point out in the onset that there are several other areas one must master besides training in order to get the best performance from a horse. Of those, I would include nutrition, certainly, good knowledge of shoeing and balancing, some insight into the psychology and general health of the horse, a knowledge of tack and equipment used in the industry, and ability as a stable manager, and I think a good appreciation of conformation. I have some principles I would like to relate that I've found important. Training is conditioning of the horse's body. Conditioning a body made up of hoof, bone, cartilage, tendon, ligament, and muscle. It's a process of stress and adaptation. Stress resulting in a greater degree of adaptation without tissue failure. Too much stress exceeding a horse's capacity to adapt will end up with tissue failure. Training should maximize the density of bone and other mechanical components. It also should maximize the respiratory system's ability to deliver oxygen to muscle. I would suggest an appreciation of interval or progressive training as a three-part program, each part expected to take approximately 3 months in time. The first stage is one of long, slow work, progressively loading miles that enhance both bone and cartilage density while building muscle mass. During this period, colts are gated, initial corrective shoeing is taking place. They learn to get along in company. It is also important to encourage a positive attitude. Most yearlings that I have come into training today are physically capable of going 4 miles at a 5 minute rate almost from the beginning. I want them to be able to go 8 miles at a 4 minute rate before moving on to the next stage. This period is a time when one can evaluate each colt's state of maturity. It's a time when weaknesses will show up. Weaknesses must be identified and dealt with accordingly. Hot areas have to be given a chance to return to normal before going on. During this period, the ration is increased close to the ultimate levels. When our colts are going 6 miles a day, I find that they're easily capable of carrying the 4 minute rate of speed. When we add the additional 7 and 8 miles onto the training program, we try and hold them down to that 4 minute rate of speed, although there are times when they'll certainly exceed it. When I do add the 7th and 8th mile onto the training program, we go to 4 day a week workouts on a 2 days off and 2 days on basis. The 2 days off between working miles, they're jogged singly anywhere from 4 to 6 miles. When these colts are going their 8 mile workouts, 8 mile a day workouts for 4 days of the week and doing it in a solid fashion, they're ready to move on to the next stage of training. Now by a solid fashion, I mean that the legs must be cold between workouts. They must possess manners necessary for racing. They also have to be carrying their body straight out on the track. The second stage, designed to enhance the cardiovascular system, develop stride and coordination, delivers 2 tough workouts a week. It consists of approximately 9 to 10 miles in distance travel. That's the main reason I like to take these colts up to 8 miles when they're doing their slow jogging exercises. I begin with a 2 mile warm up, 2 miles in 7 minutes, jogging for 10 to 15 minutes to let them fully recover their respiratory system. Go another 2 miles in approximately 6:50 and spend another 10 to 15 minutes cooling down afterwards. horses progress from this speed to a 6 minute or 5:40 2 mile workout using the same procedure. As speed is increased, distance of the actual workout is decreased. After the 6 minute mile point, I change to 1.5 mile workouts. And when they're doing these nicely in 4 minutes, I'll switch to 3 1-mile workouts using the same procedure of warming up, full recovery of the respiratory system, and cooling down after the workout. We do this until they're capable of going the last of their 3 mile session in 2:30 or even 2:25, and doing this without tiring. That being accomplished, they're ready to enter the final stage, designed to specifically condition the muscle to work anaerobically. Workouts still cover approximately the same distance traveled when jogging between works are added up. Time between workouts is shortened to 7 minutes and then to 5 minutes. Work miles are shortened first to 3/4 miles and finally to 1/2 mile distances. We train usually the 3/4 miles anywhere between, well, a final session would be covering the distance in 1:50 and the final mile in, or 3/4 mile in 1:35. At that point, I feel I'm ready to go on to the 1/2 mile workouts, and we train these down to racing speeds. An example of this, two halves in 1:02 should give you a race mile in 2:04. That is the general area where we start two-year-olds. During this period, I would also get schooling accomplished, introduce them to the starting gate, possibly even qualifying races at that time. That's basically the program we follow. If there are some questions you have about it, feel free to ask them at this time.
How many halves and three-quarters do?
3/4 miles, we would do 4 of them, and 1/2 miles, generally 6. These workouts would always be adjusted if we feel it's necessary. One of the great things about interval training a horse, you get to stop at the 3/4 pole and decide whether you should be going that last quarter or not.
First of all, you're looking at some workouts taking place at Sunshine Meadows in Florida. Great place to train. When your horse approaches a 220 rate of speed and goes below 220, you're doing some highly anaerobic work. Work that can become fatiguing for the horse. Especially if you've taken a chance and shortened the cardiovascular stage of conditioning. Even with a completely well-developed cardiovascular stage, you have to be very careful crossing this 220 threshold and working on down from there. It's a difficult painstaking process to keep the horse sound from 220 on down. You've got to be very aware of the animal. Typically, as I was telling you before, we take the miles, triple miles, down to anywhere from 215 to 210, depending on the horse, and then shift to multiple three-quarter workouts. Right now, you're watching a trotter in the middle of multiple miles, and the next horse that goes, we're working several horses out on this track at the same time. The next horse that goes will be a pacer delivering four times three-quarter workouts. The four three-quarters, we use 7-minute rest periods between, and we spread the times out on the three-quarters by 10 seconds. So if we're doing a three-quarter in 150 is the first heat, the fourth heat will be in 140. And we go 150, 147, 145, 142, and 140, something like that. Again, you can't hit these times perfectly accurately, but you can try to come close. The idea of the multiple three quarters is to bring the horse to either racing speed or to a point where he flattens out. In other words, we'll take the horses all the way down to a 130 fastest three-quarter, possibly a 129 or a 128 fastest of four three-quarters. In these workouts, it's essential that you do a warm-up, and then it's essential that you do a warm-down. And the reason you do a warm-down is that the, here goes the pacer, the reason you do a warm-down is because the horse's muscle cells are full of lactate at the end of a workout like this. And that lactate should be pumped out into the bloodstream so it can be transferred to other muscle cells that can burn the lactate, use it up. And so after races and after highly anaerobic workouts like these, a mile to a mile and a half worth of easy jog keeps the horse from getting muscle sore, tying up, helps to keep them from tying up. The best thing you can do to avoid tying up is to keep the daily workload consistent. In other words, if you're jogging 4, 5, 6 miles, whatever it is, stay there. Don't start going, giving the horse days off and days on. If you get inconsistent with your exercise, then no matter what you do with your feed, your horse will start to tend to tie up. So we take these four times three quarters all the way down to 130 fastest. If we did a 130 fastest, we'd do a 140 slowest. But sometimes what you find out is that the horse will tend to flatten out somewhere around a 133 or 205 mile rate. And when the horse flattens out and you do several workouts in a row and you just can't break through 133, then typically we go to half miles. We do the same thing with the multiple mile heats. If we get into a place where the animal tends to want to just flatten out and not deliver faster than, let's say, a 218 or a 216, then we go under the mile with the multiple three quarters and try to gain our extra speed that way. Here we're into the type of conditioning that interval training was really designed to deliver. At the middle distance, we're targeting this horse for a mile race. Mile race is probably 60 to 80% anaerobic exercise, builds a lot of lactate. We're training the horse in almost all of the exercise is anaerobic work. That means all four heats are anaerobic work. Well, if you look at the typical 225, 215, 205, or 235, 225, 215 conventional training process, what you have is 5 miles that are irrelevant and not directed toward racing speeds, and 1 mile a week that is near racing speeds but not fast enough to actually enable the horse to gain and to go ahead and to get better. That's unfortunate because what we're finding is that even with standardbreds, horses are being asked to race themselves into shape. The horse gets sucked along on 158 and suddenly he's a 158 horse, while he's only been trained in 205 at best, and some tracks he's only trained in 210. If you've got a track, for example, that you can only train in 210 because of the condition of the track, interval training may not be for you, because interval training demands that you deliver the speed that the horse is going to experience in a race. And if you don't, you just won't have the horse. Imagine that you had a horse that could deliver a 2 minute mile in a race, and you want that horse to go in 157 or 155, whatever the horse could possibly do. And imagine you were trying to get this change made by way of conventional training. Well, the only way to get that change made is to train at or near 158 or 157. If you train in 202, you're training the horse away from a 157. He may improve because you've been training him in 205 prior to this time, but really the specificity of the exercise, the key word here is specific exercise, is training the horse away from the lactate levels, the neuromuscular coordination, the firepower, so many hundreds of thousands of muscle cells firing at once. A 202 trains the horse away from a 157. But now, of course, if you train the horse in 157, you're risking, or you try to train the horse in 157, you're risking injury. You're risking the fact that the horse will become fatigued in the middle of this workout and just be down at the fetlocks, struggling to cross the finish line and get himself hurt. So you have a dilemma. How do you get a 157 mile out of a 2 minute racehorse without training him in 157 for the mile? The answer is you go shorter but faster in multiple heats, which at any time you can abort. You can stop the workout if the horse spits the bit and comes back to you. You can always stop. If your heart rate signs show that you're getting close to the ragged edge of the animal, you can always stop the workout, call it a day, go back next time for the same workout or something slightly slower and sneak up on that 157 rate of speed. And because you're going shorter, the horse can go faster more safely. And because you're keeping partial recovery rest periods between the exercises, between the heats of exercise, you end up tying together those 4 3/4 to give you the staying power that you need to deliver an entire mile at the new rate of speed. So what you've got here with interval training is a lot of effort, a lot of exercise concentrated right at the target time, or very near to the target time that you're looking for in the race. And typically, if you get a 130 in a 4 3/4 workout, the fastest in 130, you can count on having a 2 minute horse. If you get a 129, you can count on having a sub 2 minute horse. This is not the end of the process. There is certainly more training that can be done down the half miles, and we'll talk about that in a minute. But you try to take your horse down as far as you possibly can with the multiple 3/4. Now, one of the errors made in the conventional approach is to stop conditioning when the horse is at qualifying time. In other words, you just heard Doug Arthur talking about that. Get the horse down to qualifying time and let's go to the races. I would rather have the horse fit to do far better than qualifying time, fit to go ahead and qualify, but be 4 or 5 seconds faster than qualifying time so that the qualifier is easy and the first few races are easy. And you can keep conditioning the horse through racing. In other words, you race once a week and you do an interval workout once a week. And don't presume to know how fast your horse is. We've got trotters going in 152 now. That was unheard of just a couple years ago. And pacers going in 149.1 was thought to be an impossibility when I first suggested that pacers could go in 145. There's nothing to stop a pacer from going in 145 with the right training protocol and the right animal. Wellwood Hanover was a horse that could have gone in 145. And there are horses out there right now that can go that fast, or at least can go that fast for a half, and if they were trained to sustain their high rate of speed, they could deliver an entire mile at that rate. So you don't presume to know where your horse is going to end up. You don't presume that, hey, this horse is bred to be a 158 pacing horse or a 158 trotter. You presume that he's a 149 miler or better until he proves otherwise. And that means you take your workouts down as far as you can comfortably and safely go with the horse. If he's bright-eyed and bushy-tailed and says, hey, I love that work, keep it coming, then he's the kind of natural athlete that you're looking for, and you don't stop short on those horses. It's easy to stop short on because they come together very well, very quickly, and look good and feel good and race very well and stay sound without much exercise. These are the horses that are natural athletes that have what we call acquisition. In other words, this animal you hit with a big piece of work today and 3 days later he's better for it. It sticks to his ribs. He's a better athlete 3 days later. Another horse you hit with the same piece of work and it knocks him out for a week, and you have to go back a step to try to bring him forward again. Well, your natural athletes are the ones that have the most potential for leverage in terms of training. The more you train them, the better you train them, they're going to be far much better than horses with a mediocre ability to respond to conditioning. So you first start out with the assumption that you have a natural athlete and that you can take him down as far as you want to go or as far as he can possibly go. And this is where you do it in the multiple three quarters. These you take down to when the horse just flattens out and just will not from week to week do a faster 4 3-quarter workout. Now as you're moving down through the 3 quarters and as you're moving down from the miles at 220 and on down, you have to slice that speed a little at a time. You can't force the horse or put him in company or just let him go 4 seconds faster on a mile today than he did last week. You just can't do that. You can't afford that because surprises bother the structural system. Surprises may not hurt the attitude of the horse, may actually turn the horse racy and make him really want to go, but the structural components are still building. They have to continue to build all the way through the process. That's why a depth of exercise, a depth of workload is very important. If you skip the workloads or you shorten the workloads, or in this case if you open up the rest periods from 7 minutes to 10 minutes, or when we do the halves from 5 minutes to 7 minutes, you're changing the process. You're backing away from what is necessary to deliver the animal. Better is to go slower, is to take it a slice at a time and go with what the horse is saying. Any day that you have a dozen horses in your stable and they all go out and do exactly the same exercise in the same speeds, someone's not paying attention to the individual animals. Each animal is an individual and has to be trained by what it's telling you it can do, not by what the chart says for Thursday afternoon on August 28th. So, as you're walking through, you want to take the horse to his very best ability, but you want to do it a step at a time, a slice at a time, a little piece here and a little piece there. Okay, now this is the fourth of, or this is the third, I think, three quarters for this pacer. And that clocking there, that 137, is actually, the stopwatch was stopped too soon. It's hard to see the poles out there from this television picture. Here comes his last heat. Now, you can see that he's lathered up pretty good. It's in Florida, and it's kind of warm. And the white lather, we prefer not to see the white lather. The white lather tends to make us think that he's burning protein rather than carbohydrates. And is somewhat unfit for this work. However, on this animal, we're taking the heart rate on him each time, and the heart rate has indicated that at least from the cardiovascular situation and from the lactate levels, he's fit to go this final heat without slowing down and without becoming over fatigued. So he's going ahead and doing it. Notice that the three quarters started where on the track wherever the trainer happened to be at the time. In other words, the 7-minute rest periods are kept precise. You turn and go at 7 minutes. You don't wait till you get back to the starting line or wait till you get to the post where you can finish at the starting line. Instead, you start your intervals wherever you have to keep that rest period precise. And it's 7 minutes between three quarters. It's 5 minutes between halves. The reason I'm saying that is because I've opened them up, and when you open your rest periods up, you get shorter but faster horses. But you want a miler. You don't want a three-quarter horse. Same with the half miles. If you shoot a lot of half miles and give full recovery rest periods between, you end up with a half-mile wonder. And they're no good for standardbred racing. Here you're going to see the heart rate meter being used. This is the old heart rate meter, the offboard. At the time, there were not any good, reliable onboard heart rate meters available to us, so we're using this offboard meter. I think Gregorian chant is appropriate music for a hallowed name in racing, and Ronnie Dancer is a talented horseman following in his father's footsteps. And this year, 1987, Ronnie tried interval training for the first time and had some real good luck with it. He took four horses down with considerable improvement. A couple of them improved 4 seconds, a couple of them improved at least 2 seconds. And here's a little note on top of a newspaper article about Ganachi, who took a lifetime mark of 153-3 2 weeks after beginning interval training. And the interval training that Ronnie used was six half interval training that we're about to look at. used it right in the middle of the season. Here's Ganachi. He's winning this particular race, but here is what he looks like on the program. All of these races are after interval training. You can see the 153 and 3 there. It's his second win on the program. He's got three other wins, a second and a third, and this particular race he wins. Six wins total for 1987. In 19 starts, so you can see that interval training did him some good. Cuisinier is another animal that Ronnie trained on interval training, same way, started at the same time with this horse. And this is a program from the Bay Bridge Final down in Ocean City, $29,000 race that Cuisinier won. And again, looking at his program, you can see that he experienced considerable improvement. Here we're looking at three second places and three first places. This race, the Bay Bridge, was his fourth consecutive win. And I would say that at this point in time, Ronnie Dancer is very pleased with what I would call a crash prep interval training process, which you can do right in the middle of your season. A little guitar music for Ronnie Shore, who trained these three interval horses, again starting in mid-season. New Brett was his major accomplishment. New Brett started out with $17,000 on his card halfway through the year. And at the end of the year, he had 44 starts and $90,000 in wins. And again, improved significantly from slower than 2 minutes down to 156 and 4. This win picture was taken at that race. He won the open pace at Yonkers. He's still racing, still doing interval training, and still winning. All of the horses that Ronnie interval trained improved. Again, a 6.5 protocol. Joyce and Gary Glassbrook of Michigan interval trained Freedom's Frankie B and Maja Tenor all the way through the interval training program. You're going to see a workout here, tail end of a workout where Freedom's Frankie B is doing at the end of 3 times a mile and a half early on in his preparation. And you can see that he's exhausted. But Freedom's Frankie B went on to deliver a 156 and a piece, earned close to $100,000, was sold to the East Coast, won a couple, and then wasn't heard from until just recently. Joyce and Gary bought him back at a sale in Canada for $1,800. That's the trouble with interval training. One of the problems is that it's in a sense artificial, in that if you don't keep up the conditioning, the horse goes backwards. Okay, the 6.5 protocol is 6 times a half, 5 minute rest periods in between, with a 10 second spread between the slowest half and the fastest half. And we'll be watching a workout, and I'll talk to you a little bit more about this process. This is speed exercise. Now we're at the very tail end of the process. We're sharpening the horse to go to the races. Basically, when you do 6 halves, the fastest 2 halves that you see predict the race time. And again, you have to do this on a track that is at least close to the racetrack, or you're never going to get your job done. And you have to deliver the firepower and the speed of turnover that you'll have to in the race. Otherwise, you're not conditioning the horse to stand the exercise, stand the racing times that you're shooting for. Now, I forgive this film. It's an old film that we took originally of Frankie up in Michigan. Here he is finishing a mile and a half, the third mile and a half that he's gone through. He's tired. We started out our interval training program with 3 mile and a half. And this is another horse on the track. with 3.5 miles. Now, especially with young horses, we're just going with triple miles all the way down from 330 on down to about 210, and not going with these 1.5 miles. Some horses just can't do this. Frankie could, but you can see that this horse is done for the day. But he's not done for the year yet, because he went on to win 90,000. Joyce and Gary trained Maja Tenor and a couple other horses and ended up with more than $250,000 worth of income from racing in that year. Gary works at General Motors and Joyce runs a tack shop. And this is their racetrack on their farm. So we're shooting 6.5 miles. We want the 2 fastest half miles in racing time. That means that if you want a 2-minute horse, you'll see 2 half miles in 1 minute flat. If you want a 158 horse, you're gonna see 2 half miles in 59 flat. Again, sorry about the film. The trick to doing this is to not go too fast too soon. You've come through the 3/4, hopefully, and you're down into the 6 halves, or you've got a racehorse that you're racing and you're doing 6 halves. If you're in the middle of racing a horse and he's in 2 minutes, what I would suggest is to start with a 6 half that the fastest half goes in 101, and then I would cross on down through the 2-minute barrier and get on down to where finally the horse can do a pair of 59s back-to-back in the middle of a 6-half workout. Typically a workout like that might go from 108 or 109 to 105 to 103 to 101, another 101, possibly another 101, and then the horse might trail off a little bit by a second or two. You like a little curve there. You like to see in these halves, you like to see the horse be tired enough to have to slow down on that last half. If each half gets successively faster, and again, you're not, these people you can watch and they're not driving the horses, they're not making them go, and they're not sucking them along with faster horses. They're just asking, just kindly asking. And typically the horse on his own will do each 1/2 mile faster until he comes to a high level of fatigue, and then he'll slow down a little bit. What you don't want to do is a workout like 118, 101, 101, 107. That's a bowed tendon. You keep your workout times, your 1/2 mile times, close together, clustered around about a 10-second spread. Slowest to fastest. And when the horse does back up a couple seconds on a 1/2 mile, the workout's over. Whether you're at the 3rd heat or the 4th heat or the 5th heat, wherever the horse backs up, the workout is over. Here we're not as concerned about heart rates, because really we're maxing the horse out, and he should be ready to be maxed out. If he's not ready to be maxed out, he's not ready to race. So here we're going by what the horse is telling us almost purely, although we do monitor the heart rates and we do watch, we do tend to tell ourselves that if we're starting to see 1-minute recovery rates in excess of 140, we better start being concerned about the readiness of this horse to go on with the workout. However, I've done as many as 8 halves with a standardbred in which heart rates never drop below, after the 3rd or 4th heat, never drop below 165, even when the horse was walking. And those kinds of workouts were drills for horses that still had relatively stupid legs, still were not into the pacing role, and had to learn to go fast the hard way. They went on and raced and won. In fact, all the horses that you're looking at, except for the first horse that we looked at in at Cornell University way back in the middle of the tape, all of these horses have won races. There's not any horse pictured here that has not won a race. None of them were injured so that they couldn't perform. So what we're looking at here is a workout that is speed specific. What we're doing is we're teaching tens of thousands more muscle cells to fire at once, and we're going almost strictly fast twitch muscle cell here. We're still building oxidative capacity, we're still building structural strength, building all the things. The cardiovascular strength continues to be built, but really we're directing ourselves specifically at speed, and the fact that we're giving 5-minute rest periods between these half miles means that we're still building a miler, we're not building a half miler. And everybody's asked me on these 6 half workouts whether the horse will learn to quit at the end of a half. Believe me, what you end up with is a horse that delivers an entire mile and doesn't think about quitting. Although if you get a driver that tries to stick them in a hole, these horses tend, if you do a lot of the half miles, they tend to want to get out and go. And if you fight the horse that's been trained this way, you'll cost yourself 2 seconds on a mile, because the horse, you'll discourage him. That doesn't mean they're speed crazy, it just means that they want to go. They'll some of the younger ones that get a little bit too much half mile work, I've had one that actually the driver tried to put him in a hole and he went right over the top of a horse in front of him just because he could not be held. And when you're racing one of these horses, the thing you can count on is that you've got the fittest horse on the racetrack. You've got a horse that's been steeled to deliver a full mile of all-out effort. And you can use horses like this. You can actually go out and ask them to run the entire mile. If you have to cut it, you can cut it. If you have to go around the outside, you can go around the outside. The horse that gets through this process is kind of a push-button horse. You can do what you want with him. Ask him at any time and he'll deliver for you. They're enthusiastic racehorses. This kind of a workout, or a 4 half workout, or 3 3-quarters, are workouts that you use between races. If you race on Saturday, then on Wednesday you come back out with a workout like this. And you keep trying from week to week to get better fastest halves. In other words, you're always trying to improve the horse. The horse can improve forever. Sometimes you'll get to the bottom of the animal and you won't be able to get it anymore, and the horse will back up. That's the time to give him a break, 2, 3, 4 weeks, and then come back on with more interval training and bring him back down to an even faster racing speed, which can be done, has been done quite often. Freedom's Frankie B was held together with lighter exercises, 3 times a half, and not always midweek. Sometimes he'd race on Saturday and race on the next Saturday with no interval workout in between. Again, you deal with the individual. You are always watching what the individual likes, and go with the horse. Horses are horses, and I like to, whenever I can, show standardbred people what thoroughbred people are doing, and show thoroughbred people what standardbred people are doing. In this case, we have a horse shooting multiple 3/4 heats at near, very near racing rates. This is the final tough workout for this thoroughbred. The thing to know about thoroughbred training is that to a thoroughbred trainer and rider, a mile is a marathon, and it's extremely difficult to persuade a thoroughbred trainer that 6 miles a day is possible for his horse, in spite of the fact that thoroughbreds commonly race in these 25 mile endurance races. They do 3-day eventing. These are broken down thoroughbreds, typically do 3-day eventing and all sorts of events that require miles and miles and miles of training. and the horses do very well in them. But the racetrack environment is such that out here in California, for example, the typical rider charges $7 for one trip around the track and hops from horse to horse all morning long and earns himself a couple hundred dollars a day doing that. So to ask one to do 6 miles is to ask him to forfeit his day's pay. It's like doing 6 different horses. So it's a real difficult problem to get interval training done on thoroughbreds, but nevertheless it's being done, and in thoroughbreds we've delivered several million dollars worth of wins with interval trained horses. Probably the best of all horses was an animal named Stanera, who raced and won the Japan Cup at 1.5 miles, and was known as the Iron Mare because she raced at Ascot. During the 7-day Ascot meet, she raced 1.25 miles on Monday and won that with Grade 1 stakes. Then came back on Friday and raced 1.5 miles in another Grade 1 stakes and won that and set a track record at Ascot, which has been in business for a while. Stanera was a horse trained by its owner, Frank Dunn of Ireland, who flew over and came down and asked all about interval training and how to do it. And then he went back to Ireland and tripled the exercise protocol. Stanera was doing 15 miles a day every day and eating as much as at the height of her training. She was eating 25 pounds of grain and free choice hay along with that. So that's our best thoroughbred interval training experience, although trainers like Colin Hayes, who just won the Melbourne Cup, which is Australia's biggest race, he's got a 3/4 mile uphill gallop that he shoots 3 times. That's his workout, is 3 times up that hill. It's a good steep hill for 3/4 mile, and he does that eventually. He does it in near racing time. So that's a pretty strenuous workout, and he does that with all of his thoroughbreds, and he's the top trainer in Australia. In England, Michael Stout uses multiple heat workouts with his thoroughbreds and does very. He's the top trainer in Europe right now. So these workouts are here to demonstrate that interval training doesn't kill horses. If it's going to kill horses, the most fragile, quote, fragile of the animals, the thoroughbred, should be the one to suffer the most. And thoroughbreds, if they're brought along gradually and the mileage is built and the program is kept consistent the way it's supposed to be done, then thoroughbreds have no trouble whatsoever in completing the entire process and going through the races exceptionally fit. We've had thoroughbreds do 4 3/4 and 5 half miles, again, 7-minute rest period between the 3/4 and 5-minute rest period between the halves, and live through it and win stakes races. Other horses, Image of Greatness, Nijinsky's Secret, I don't know if you've heard of these, but these are multi-$100,000 winners. And again, the rider here, we've got, we're taking heart rates at the end of each workout, and with thoroughbreds, we're especially careful because the interval training process for thoroughbreds, in my own experience, is still somewhat experimental in that we don't know what it takes to break down a thoroughbred. We're being extremely careful with the thoroughbreds because we're not sure how far we can go. And with standardbreds, I learned how far we can go with standardbreds way back at the Little Brown Jug Track in Delaware, Ohio. First 12 horses that we bought, we tried full interval training done by in the way that a human half miler is trained, and we found out that the difference between a human and an equine athlete is that you can't bring the equine athlete to the same level of fatigue that you can the human. In other words, once the equine athlete becomes fatigued, his biomechanics go all out of shape, and his fetlocks droop to the ground, and he starts taking erroneous steps and is bound at some point in time to do damage to himself. So we learned what those limits were with the Standardbreds with the first 12 horses, and redesigned our program and went back to work with the Standardbreds in a more modest program, and came out with a program that right now just doesn't fail, just tends not to fail at all. With Thoroughbreds, we're still experimenting with how far we can go without injuring the horse. This is the final heat. We'll just listen to a little bit of it. Okay, just by way of review, your 6-half workout for a horse that wants to go in 2 minutes looks like what you see on the screen. Starting out in about a 108, then going to 105, 102, 1 minute, 1 minute, and the horse should fall off a little at the end of the work. Same thing for a 158 racehorse, you want to see a pair of 59s in the middle. 5 minute rest periods between. Anytime the horse falls off 2 seconds, quit. Anytime you do hard work with a horse, you'd expect that some tissue is being broken down and will repair quickly if you don't overdo the exercise. The whole idea of an exercise program that's scientifically designed is that there are no surprises to the horse's body, no insults to tissue. Nevertheless, you still run into small swellings, small sorenesses, odds and ends that come up that you have to try to prevent if you can, or treat. Now, one of the things we do with the horses we interval train is that after every hard workout, we, for 20 minutes, wrap their legs in ice bandages. And the way we do these bandages is that we start with a bucket of ice, water, and alcohol, the water and alcohol mixed 50-50. And we soak the bandages in the ice water while the horse is doing the work. And when the horse comes back from the track, we wrap the legs past the knees and past the hocks. It takes two polo bandages to do this on each leg. So a typical horse will get eight bandages put on them after the work. And the bandages are relatively loosely wrapped. The horse stands still while this is going on. Sometimes we'll put them on the hot walker after being wrapped, but usually we do it in the stall. And this is, by the way, the thoroughbred that you saw do the interval works just a little while ago. The process that we learned this from Dr. Rita Garrison, who is an equine veterinarian from Oklahoma. And this tends to keep all the little edemas, all the little swellings that normally want to appear as the horse's immune system takes over and tries to go rapidly to the attack in repairing or immobilizing joints while the tissues repair. The horse has an exceptionally strong reaction to small injuries, and really what you want to do is keep this kind of swelling down. Now, we don't wrap our horses, unless we have an injury, we don't wrap them overnight because we want to see the signs. We want to see the injuries that we've caused, if we've caused any, and back off the work and treat them properly until the legs come back together again. So overnight we don't wrap the horse, but after every hard workout for 20 minutes we use what is called cryotherapy, which basically this cold causes the blood vessels to contract and keeps the fluid normally coming from the lymphatic system from filling areas that it normally wants to fill after some tissue has been destroyed. We wrap the legs and we make little pockets in the bandages and take the alcohol bottle that we use to mix the water alcohol mixture with and pour the rest of the water into the bandages. This tends to keep the legs tight all the way through the process, and it tends to highlight the times when you've actually caused a significant new injury. If your legs are looking tight on an everyday basis and you cause a minor injury, typically that injury will show up as much as 3 days or 4 days after you caused it. And you want to be aware of it. So typically we keep a nice tight leg. We don't have boggy legs. We don't have try to avoid round ankles, filled pockets in the ankles. But when we get them, they're very obvious because they show up when they're not supposed to be there. And then we know to back up, get a good diagnosis, and treat or rest the animal. We'll use ultrasound scanning, we'll use infrared thermography. Infrared thermography is a device that sees heat. It gives you, you point it at a horse and you get a video picture of the animal that is essentially a thermal map of his legs. So you can see exactly where the injury is trying to occur. And we've used it on standardbreds and on thoroughbreds, and you can see everything with it. You can see anything from knee and ankle chips to bowed tendons coming on to splints coming on or splints going away. On thoroughbreds, you can see buck shins. You can see fractures. Anything from the knees on down and the hocks on down, you can see. And occasionally, if you've got a sore joint bursa or a back problem or some kind of a pinched nerve, that's visible as well. Sometimes you can see muscle damage if the horse ties up and one muscle in particular ties up. You can see that that muscle has a lot more inflammation in it than the rest. Finally, again, we're to go after the feet and go after the ankles. We'll take the horse and put his feet in the ice water, whatever ice water we've got left. We'll typically put that foot in the bucket. Before and after every fast piece of work, whether it's a race or a workout, you have to do, or you should do, a warm-up and warm-down. The purpose of the warm-up is to get circulation going, to stretch the tendons and ligaments, get them warm, get the muscles warm so that they function properly, get the blood circulating, pump up the horse. And typically, we like to do 2.5 miles worth of jog before any workout, and then to flush the lactate from the muscle cells, approximately a mile of jogging afterwards. All of this is extremely beneficial and should not be ignored. A cold horse going into a workout is in trouble. A cold horse going into a race, as every standardbred trainer knows, is in trouble. Most thoroughbred horses and most quarter horses don't know anything about warm-ups. The pre-race warm-up, though, we don't do any training. We don't do our training miles on race day. Instead, we use all the available fuel for the races. And instead, what we do is when we go out to score, we'll do a lot of jog miles during the race meet, but when we go out to score, we score the first score at high speed. In other words, a quarter of a mile at high speed will dump the spleen and cause all the red blood cells to be there when the horse goes to the starting gate. The second score, we just jog through it so the horse can recover and pay back the fuel that he used during the first score. So he comes to the gate fully loaded with fuel and fully loaded with the red blood cells. We use scales to weigh our horses, and the reason for that being is that in a typical race or in a typical workout, the horse will lose weight, and most of that weight is water and glycogen, muscle glycogen. The horse burns fuel when he races, and we want to see what that fluctuation is like. In Hong Kong and some of the Asian countries, the horse's weight is posted as part of the racing form, so that people bet when they know the horse is at his racing weight, and they don't bet when they think the horse is not at his racing weight. And I can tell you that every human athlete knows precisely what his fighting weight is, and a few pounds over or a few pounds under, he doesn't perform as well. This is to do with the fuel supply. A horse that has been exercised hard and hasn't had time to repay the fuel of that exercise is going to be a short horse on the racetrack. If he's not fed enough carbohydrates, he'll be short. He won't deliver the full distance. The horse that is overfed is fat and is carrying around a few extra pounds that he doesn't need. So you have to regulate the weight. You're looking at a scale there with four platforms on it. You can weigh each leg individually and weigh the front and back of the horse to see where the center of gravity is moving. With the four plates, you can see which leg the horse doesn't want to stand on, which gives you an indication of lameness in that leg. And you can get the total body weight, all accurate, to within a tenth of a percent. Scale is a basic, vital tool in my mind. Typically in nutrition, what we want is a basic, good, balanced, sweet feed, like Carnation Super Horse, Omeline 300, Purina Blue Seal Canner, those types of feeds that run typically 14 to 16% crude protein. And basically you feed the exercise. You don't feed 18 pounds a day when the horse is doing 2 miles, but when the horse is doing full intervals with long jog miles on the days off, he'll eat and demand as much as 18 pounds of sweet feed a day, plus free choice hay, mixed hay, likes to feed both alfalfa and grass hay so that both types of gut flora stay alive and vital, and then a vitamin and mineral supplement that balances out the needs of the horse. Standardbred is an athlete. He earns his keep and his money at the racetrack. The owner buys the raw material and sends it to a trainer, and the trainer's job is to preserve and enhance that raw material. And too often today we tend to be afraid. The higher the price of the yearling, the more inhibition there is on the trainer to do anything different than the other guy down the shed row. If you do something different and the horse gets hurt, you're to blame, and you'll lose your owner's horses. In the thoroughbred business, it's far worse because there's much bigger prices, and because thoroughbreds, because of the way they're trained, or not trained, they're not trained hardly at all, most thoroughbreds, 65%, become injured very quickly. In the standardbreds already, there's a lot of good conditioning and a lot of good, exceptionally good horsemanship, exceptionally good farriery going on. So the problem's not anywhere near as great in standardbreds as it is in thoroughbreds. At least you've got a chance, an owner has a chance to make a profit in racing a standardbred. In the thoroughbred business, that possibility is so remote that most owners, and the quarter horse business is worse than the thoroughbred business. So already standardbreds are doing, standardbred trainers are doing a great conditioning job. This tape is just showing you that there is a possibility of rearranging slightly what you're already doing to make for a better racehorse. And 4 or 5 years ago when I was first talking about this, and even before that when it was just philosophy, and back at Delaware, Ohio, Curly Smart was telling me that a college boy like me doesn't really belong in the horse racing business. I ought to go on and go to college and be a doctor or something. But we've demonstrated now, we've shown for certain that interval training is an improvement on the conventional system of training standardbreds and thoroughbreds and quarter horses and Arabian horses. We've had stakes winners in all four breeds. We're not killing horses. It's a good process. I hope you'll try it. I just want to remind you of the rules again. Believe the horse. That's the first thing to remember about interval training, is believe the horse. When he says it's time to quit, it's time to quit. Stop a workout in the middle of a heat. Stop it three heats in. Stop it whenever the horse says it's over, because he's telling the truth. And basically, we want the horse to be enthusiastically drawing us on. If he slows down, if he still wants to go, but he slows down a little bit, quit then. And never, and this is a bigger problem with thoroughbred trainers than standardbred trainers, but don't go out and try him for a 205 mile right in the middle of the cardiovascular stage. Take the speed on a slice at a time. Never go out and surprise the horse's body with a big jump in speed. Again, feed the work. The more he works, the more he needs in carbohydrates. If you don't supply the carbohydrates, he'll get muscle sore. Injections and firing and blistering are for cripples, and really not useful in cripples either. But we don't want cripples. We want to prevent, and we don't want to cover up injuries that are coming on just so we can go on and train the horse and look good. Instead, we want to preserve that raw material. And that sometimes means taking a longer time and being easy with the horse. No matter what you're doing with the animal, always make the conservative decision. Never, always think in terms of conservative. Don't, if there's a question of whether you should go on or not, don't. And finally, don't cut this thing short. Don't start in the middle of speed training when you should be doing cardiovascular work. It takes about 9 months to bring a baby through this process. It takes about 6 to 7 months to bring a racehorse through the entire process. Don't cut it short. I want to thank you very much for buying this tape, and I hope you enjoyed it and learned something from it. And stay in touch. We want to hear what happens. Thank you.